Welcome to Sisters of Thunder. I'm Yvette Schneider, and I'm here with Kathy Baldock.
Hello.
This is a continuation of a podcast we did a couple of weeks ago on the guidelines for psychological practice with transgender and gender nonconforming people that the American Psychological Association put out that was adopted by the Council of Representatives August 5th and 7th, 2015.
So this is pretty new, and this is why we're doing this. And Yvette got hold of this and brought it to our attention to read. And there were a couple of things that struck me right away about it, how thorough it is. There are 16 guidelines in this.
I think 16 guidelines, right?
And it was how long was the study?
It was put together over the course of 6 years, the past 6 years, and it was done by a group of people, of psychologists. Five are transgender, five are cisgender. I think six were white, and one was mixed race, one of Chinese descent, one of Indian descent.
Good.
Forget the other one. So,
it's a diverse group. Always impresses me when I look at reports, when I look at studies, is the number of pages. I think this one has 17 pages of documented studies, and you can't get but a few sentences through this where they're already citing a study. And the reason that we wanted to do this was a few weeks ago. You can look back in the podcast schedule. We talked about Family Research Council had done a policy paper on that included what they think is medical and science statuses or opinions on transgender people. And the studies they referred to were from the 60s and 70s. And just the contrast in these two papers, you can easily hear by going back to that podcast. And going back to the podcast, part one of this, which was 2 weeks ago on the APA, and just contrasting of who are you going to listen to, people that do research and studies or people that are fitting their opinions into their worldview or their politics or their ideology. And that's the difference, is this is research and study. So I so appreciate Yvette bringing this to our attention to talk about, because I think it still may not be published yet. So this is pretty new information.
No, it's not out yet. It'll probably be out in the next release of their magazine.
So we've already done six of the guidelines in the old podcast. These are a little faster. Well, one of them is terribly slow.
One of them's slow, but the next are fast. This will only be this podcast. We won't go into a third on it. But this is guideline seven. We're at seven. Psychologists understand the need to promote social change that reduces the negative effects of stigma on the health and well-being of transgender and gender nonconforming people. And I think it's important to mention here that these are guidelines. We talked about this last time, that guidelines are aspirations where they're not rules.
Right.
This is just what they're striving to achieve. And this isn't true for all psychologists. The only psychologists who are really allowed to see someone who is transgender or gender nonconforming are those who specialize in this. If they don't, they need to refer you to someone else.
And we found out last week also by going through the paper and going through the studies that only 30% of licensed therapists really have some experience with this. So if you're a person that has a trans child or is trans or is trying to understand this issue or some reason to go for a therapist, make sure you're asking appropriate questions, that you're getting one of those 30% that understands this issue. You know?
Well, if they're not of the 30%, they do have to refer you to someone else. And they don't necessarily have to leave it up to you to find your own therapist. If you call someone, you can ask for referrals.
Oh.
And they do need to help you with that.
Wow.
Where if they honestly don't know, they may send you to the APA website. That may be the extent of the help they can offer. But most, and they actually should all be able to direct you to someone else who can help you if they can't.
Right.
So the psychologists understand the need to promote social change. that reduces the negative effects of stigma on the health and well-being of transgender and gender non-conforming people. There's a lack of public policy that addresses these needs and these significant hardships that right. TGNC people face. A lot of states, they don't have laws that protect them from employment or housing, that offer employment or housing protection, so they can be fired and they can lose their housing. And these are things that psychologists you wouldn't think about would need to know, and they would need to know how to deal with in a patient, to how to help them, because they can consider, they can experience challenges in
simple
requiring
tasks.
Documentation yeah. that they may not be able to get to secure employment without documentation that aligns with their gender identity and gender expression.
So can you imagine a therapist being this insensitive to say, well, you seem to be depressed because you're sitting at home. Why don't you just go out and get a darn job? And not understanding that the person, their certificates, their driver's license, their birth certificate, their Social Security card, their passport, all those core documents
right.
do not
right.
match the gender that they're in. So not only is it difficult to then to secure employment, but it's quite an embarrassing, stressful ordeal to go and have to deal with that. So that would be something that a therapist should understand.
And psychologists, therapists need to understand that not everyone's experience is the same.
Ugh.
Not everyone chooses to undergo or can afford to undergo a medical transition.
Yeah. So that's an important point you just said, that everybody's story is not the same. So the saying that's said is, so if you heard a story about a transgender person, you've heard a story about a transgender
right,
person.
One transgender person.
Right.
So they need to understand and know how to help. But not only how to help the individual patient, but they're also being asked and encouraged to help change policy.
Yes. I think that's wonderful.
Because they are in a position to do that. They are the experts. So instead of just saying, well, this is my patient, I'm going to deal with my patient's individual issues. No, what the American Psychological Association is saying is, what we would like you to do is to go out and use your expertise to help change policy to make the lives of transgender and gender nonconforming people easier.
So that means that therapists might consider getting involved in when their state legislatures have this come up as issues. I mean, in the state of Nevada, we are a biannual legislature that meets every 2 years. And 2 years ago or a year and a half ago, we had some laws being passed on transgender people and hate crimes laws. And those are the kind of situations that therapists can get involved in and help to pass public policy, because we don't want people like FRC guiding our public policy, because their public policy is that people are grandfathered in and no other people from now on should be able to change those core birth documents. That should not be legal. That's an absurdity. That causes undue stress, emotional stress, and the already stressful and stigmatized lives of transgender and gender nonconforming
right.
people.
Right. And psychologists can also help to guide them in how to advocate for themselves.
Right.
How to
right.
appeal in court, exactly what they can do to help themselves.
Right.
And at the same time, understanding, because this is the core job of a psychologist, the burdens and the pressures that trans people are under when they have to provide so much documentation.
Yeah.
And realizing, yes, this isn't just the same as saying, you're depressed, go get a job.
Right.
You're depressed, go get involved in an activity. No, where they understand, no, this is burdensome. This is tiring. I'm drained.
And I brought this up in some webinar or podcast we did, just such a simple thing of, I went into a bar in Canada with a young, certainly not 18 looking year old trans woman, certainly could have passed for legal age of drinking a beer. And she had to take out her driver's license, which still showed she was male. And it sounds like such a small thing, but I'm telling you, Yvette, it made me cry. Just sitting and watching the humiliation of just such a, even a small act put on her. and the burden it put on her. And can you imagine the bigger things of trying to go and get unemployment or something that has to do with your Social Security and your documents don't pass, or going to another country with your passport or your driver's license, just the humiliation that other people can burden you with.
Right.
So those are things that have to be dealt with.
While the psychologist can help you with the humiliation and the feelings of being traumatized and being emotionally burdened, it's not just that, though. They can also serve as an advocate.
Yes.
And I think this is important when you think of psychologists and you think, oh, I'm just going to go and unburden on them. No, that is not their only function. They're also saying in these guidelines that the psychologist may consult the National Center for Transgender Equality, the Sylvia Rivera Law Project, or the Transgender Law Center for additional information on identity documentation, or anything else. Like, right. they can go to bat for you, and they can help you, you know, to learn different ways to help yourself that you may not know of already.
And it's just interesting that this would have, and I think it's going to come up a little bit later when we talk about elders, but how fast this has changed. Yeah, I'll save that to when we talk about elders.
Yeah.
Because this has so radically changed in 35 years. It's almost... the ways we see this are so much more enlightened. So if anybody is operating on those old rules, it's just amazing how radically this field has changed. And I love that the APA did this. So what's the next
point? I think it's excellent. And I also would encourage anyone who does fall into that category of transgender, gender nonconforming person, not to be afraid of mental health professionals, especially psychologists, especially if you go to a psychologist who is one of the experts, which, as I've said 3, 4, 5 times before, are the only ones who can see that they really are out to help you and advocate for you and not to judge.
Yeah.
Because I think that's the experience that people have had in the past, and things have changed.
Yes, and are changing.
So, yeah, not to be fearful to go out and get the kind of help that you need. So the next guideline is 8. Psychologists working with gender questioning and transgender or gender nonconforming youth understand the different developmental needs of children and adolescents, and that not all youth will persist in a TGNC identity into adulthood.
Now, this is a little minefield we're walking into, and we recognize that and realize that.
I'm going to read directly from what they said and offer not a whole lot of commentary, just so that you know exactly what they're saying, because this is an area where there hasn't been a lot of study.
No.
So they're very careful here, the APA is. Okay. Many children develop stability, that means constancy across time, in their gender identity between ages 3 to 4. Okay, this is from a study from 1966, just so you know.
And I'm pretty sure I offer on my website, Candy Walker Connections, a chapter on sex, gender, and sexual orientation. And I talk about in that chapter, it's a free audio chapter, how children come to understand what group they belong in and don't belong in and who they identify with, really between boys 2, girls 3, and by 5, they pretty much understand the group they've gotten into. So that's what you're saying.
Right. And they say, although gender consistency, which is recognition that gender remains the same across situations, often does not occur until ages 4 to 7.
So what that plays out as is a girl understands that when she sees her little brother with a penis, that she doesn't get one of those. Or a little boy will understand, you know, this, I won't wake up tomorrow and this penis will be gone. This is a gender consistency, typically, okay? There's exceptions to all of this.
Right.
I have to be so careful.
Yes. But we're talking all the way up to age 7 for this. Children who demonstrate gender nonconformity in preschool and early elementary years may not follow this trajectory. This is from a 1995 study.
Yeah.
Existing research suggests and don't get upset by any of this until I finish the whole thing. Existing research suggests that between 12% and 50% of children diagnosed with gender dysphoria may persist in their identification with a gender different than sex assigned at birth into late adolescence and young adulthood. They cite many studies for this.
Right.
However, several research studies categorized 30 to 62% of youth who did not return to the clinic for medical intervention after initial assessment and whose gender identity may be unknown as desisters. They called them desisters because they didn't come back in, who no longer, and then said that they no longer identified with a gender different than sex assigned at birth. Because they didn't come in, they assumed, oh, they went back to their identifying with their birth gender. But then the paper goes on to say, as a result, this research runs a strong risk of inflating estimates of the number of youth who do not persist with a TGNC identity.
Now, this is really important stuff, because what we're going to, and you just keep listening with these ears, is there's not lots of long-term research on children to know the percents and numbers of children that are feeling that they're gender nonconforming at early ages and following through adolescence. When we realized that we didn't even start asking kids even if they were gay until like 2005 for studies, we have to inherently know that we do not have long study number percentages on transgender and gender nonconforming children.
We don't.
We have a lot of information, but we don't have long-term studies.
Right. So this is, that greatly informs what's to come with this guideline. Research has suggested that children who identify more intensely with a gender different than sex assigned at birth are more likely to persist in this gender identification into adolescence.
Right.
That was from a study done in 2013. So now we're getting closer to today.
Mm-hmm.
And that when gender dysphoria persists through childhood and intensifies into adolescence, the likelihood of long-term transgender and gender nonconforming identification increases.
Right. So if this... this dysphoria and this identification with the non-birth sex goes from childhood through adolescence, it's probably going to stick.
Exactly. The likelihood of it sticking increases as it the longer it persists, which of course makes sense.
Right.
Gender questioning children who do not persist may be more likely to later identify as gay or lesbian than gender questioning children. So that's typically the way they've seen that this goes, is you may think, you know, the little girl who has more masculine tendencies, is more of a tomboy, may think she's a boy, want to be identified as a boy, may then later realize, oh, wait, I'm a lesbian.
Mm-hmm.
That's how it goes. So it's either, yes, I really was born with a body different from how I feel internally, or I'm gay. I'm a lesbian.
I have more masculine traits. I have more masculine thoughts. Like, so all of this says is when you start operating on the male or female, masculine or feminine, binary systems, it's going to fall apart. So we all typically, everybody has someone in their family or a friend that they know that there is a young boy in the family that just wants to put on dramatic clothing and sing all the show tunes. It doesn't mean he wants to be a girl. He could end up just being gay or a straight boy that likes show tunes.
Right.
Not that I know tons of them.
But it completely makes sense, because if you look at Prince Charming, always goes with the princess. It's always the prince and the princess, and that's all you've heard. And you think, well, I'm a girl and I'm attracted to the princess. Maybe I'm really a boy. And then as she develops, realizing, oh no, I just like girls, and that has nothing to do with my gender.
So when we get out of this very tight binary construct and we allow people to be who they are in gender identity and sexual orientation, won't it be just oh so much nicer? But we're certainly not there yet. Do we have anything more on children though?
Oh yes, we're not even close to finished with that. Okay, so this is how then. Okay, so now what do you do?
What do you do?
Psychologist.
Yeah.
A clear distinction between care of TGNC and gender questioning children and adolescents exists in the literature. Due to the evidence that not all children persist in a TGNC identity into adolescence or adulthood, and because no approach to working with TGNC children has been adequately empirically validated, mm-hmm. consensus does not exist regarding best practice with pre-pubertal children. So there's not enough empirical data to decide what a best practice is. So this is how they handle that. Then they say lack of consensus about the preferred approach to treatment may be due in part to divergent ideas regarding what constitutes optimal treatment outcomes for transgender and gender nonconforming and gender questioning youth. So there are two distinct approaches.
Yeah. Yep.
One approach encourages an affirmation acceptance of children's expressed gender identity.
Right.
So if you're a boy and that is your sex and your gender identity is as a girl, then one approach is
to affirm that you're a girl. Let you take a girl name, let you dress as a girl.
Okay, so this may include assisting children to socially transition, to begin medical transitions when their bodies have physically developed, and just to go down that road. Right? In the second approach, children are encouraged to embrace their given bodies and to align with their assigned gender roles.
Oh, that just sounds so restrictive.
Well, you have to listen to the whole thing. This includes endorsing and supporting behaviors and attitudes that align with child's sex assigned at birth prior to the onset of puberty. Clinicians, this is why I'm reading this.
Yes.
Clinicians using this approach believe that undergoing multiple medical interventions and living as a TGNC person in a world that stigmatizes gender nonconformity is a less desirable outcome than one in which children may be assisted to happily align with their sex assigned at birth.
I'm glad you're reading that because...
Let's continue. Consensus does not exist regarding whether this approach may provide benefit or may cause harm or lead to psychosocial adversities.
Yeah.
When addressing psychological interventions for children and adolescents, the World Professional Association for Transgender Health Standards of Care identify interventions, quote, aimed at trying to change gender identity and expression to become more congruent with sex assigned at birth as unethical.
Right. So they say it's unethical.
Yeah. They say that according to, you know, the standards of care from the World Professional Association for Transgender Health says that it is unethical to do that.
So what I'm hearing that approach saying is you were assigned a birth sex, live within that birth sex with your name, with the behaviors that you do, with the clothing, everything. You take the pressure to align to that birth sex because doing anything other in this non-gender conforming, doing anything in this binary gender world is going to be too stressful on you.
Right.
So you carry the burden internally so that the outside stress doesn't hurt you.
Right. And this is, we're talking here about children.
Yes.
We're talking about children here. We're not talking about adults, and we're not talking about adolescents, because then we go into adolescence. I know this is taking a long time, but to me, this is the most important section.
It is the most important section.
Much greater consensus exists regarding practice with adolescents.
Bingo.
Right?
As we said before, we're talking about
kids under 10.
So when we see that it's persisted through childhood, and now we're into adolescence, now we have greater research that shows us what to do.
And I think what most therapists would do, from what I've seen and from the therapists that I've talked to, is the former, which is, mm-hmm. going along with how the child identifies and seeing at how it progresses without imposing any standards or expectations on the child.
So
and seeing how it, let's see how this plays out into adolescence.
So I have locally two friends that have transgender children that are children, and they've let their children transition. And their choice has been to see the mental attitudes of their child when they've allowed their child to transition. So I've seen great success in those families as the parents. But a lot of this is, how do the parents operate? How do the parents behave? What context do the parents give to this whole situation? Because I've seen great success in my personal life with personal friends who have children that have transitioned successfully. So now they just watch, and that's where we are. They watch to see how this sustains with through adolescence.
Right. Then through childhood, then you get to adolescence. Adolescents presenting with gender identity concerns bring their own set of unique challenges because they're adolescents. This may include...
because they're adolescents, and there's a whole set of challenges
exactly,
with adolescents.
Exactly.
Fellow mothers, unite.
This may include having a late onset or post-pubertal presentation of gender nonconforming identification with no history of gender role nonconformity or gender questioning in childhood.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that's to be considered. Mm-hmm. This doesn't happen until adolescence. Complicating their clinical presentation, many gender-questioning adolescents also present with co-occurring psychological concerns such as suicidal ideation, self-injurious behaviors, drug and alcohol use, and autism spectrum disorders. That's one thing. Additionally, adolescents can become intensely focused on their immediate desires, resulting in outward displays of frustration and resentment when faced with any delay in receiving the medical treatment from which they feel they would benefit and to which they feel entitled.
Well, we could fill in anything right. in this blank. You have two teenage daughters, or almost teenage yeah. one, and I've had a teenage daughter, and my son was much easier on this, but you can't tell teenagers, let's just see how this plays out in 3 or 4 years.
No.
It's like, no.
I want this.
We talked about this in August. It's September.
I've waited long enough.
Yes. We talked about it last night. Now what are we going to do about it today?
Yeah, that's typically our conversation over cell phones. This intense focus on immediate needs may create challenges in assuring that adolescents are cognitively and emotionally able to make life-altering decisions to change their name or gender marker, begin hormone therapy, which may affect fertility, or pursue surgery. Nonetheless, there is greater consensus that
yes.
treatment approaches for adolescents affirm an adolescent's gender identity. Treatment options for adolescents extend beyond social approaches to include medical approaches. One particular medical intervention involves the use of puberty-suppressing medications, or blockers, GnRH analog, which is a reversible medical intervention used to delay puberty for appropriately screened adolescents with gender dysphoria.
And this is a big statement. So you'll hear some people on the other side of this issue saying, stop messing with children. These parents are messing with children. Puberty blockers stop those secondary sex characteristics. Hairy
right.
bodies, Adam's apple, deepening voice, breasts, wider hips, different fat distributions. So if you have a child that's adolescent and you're still in the process of trying to figure out, is this going to stick? Is this what the child wants? Is this what the therapist suggests? All these things, a hormone blocker will just stop that process of the secondary sex characteristics coming on, so you can figure out, is this really where we want to go? And big, big flash, it's absolutely reversible.
Right.
You can, when you stop the hormone blockers, puberty will onset.
Right.
Huge, huge piece of information.
Right, exactly. So what psychologists are encouraged to do is to regularly review the current literature in the area, since there's more and more coming out
right.
all the time, recognizing that the research is limited. regarding the potential benefits and risks of different treatment approaches for children and for adolescents, and to walk through this with the parents to keep the parents completely informed at all times of what their options are, of what the research says.
And so that's big, is because this is in 5 years. We could know a lot more because of the research that we have on children, not adolescents, the research we have on adolescents, the understanding we have about gender, the understanding is this field is changing so quickly that a therapist needs to be up to date, and people need to make sure they're participating with informed therapists.
So what's key here is adolescents and their families may need support in tolerating ambiguity and uncertainty with regard to gender identity and its development. It is encouraged that care should be taken not to foreclose this process. And I think that's where people get so frustrated, is that, well, what is it?
Well, what's the first question? What's the first question anybody asks when you have a baby? What'd you have?
Yeah.
Boy or girl? That's it. You know, and if it's a girl, it's this for the rest of her life.
Right.
And if it's a boy, it's this for the rest of his life. That's the way it is.
And the families, what they're saying here is the families have a hard time tolerating that, too. So the psychologist's job is to say, hey, we're going to live in the gray area.
Yeah.
And we're going to see how this plays out. And they're being encouraged, do not foreclose on this process. It's a process.
Yeah. Yep.
It's actually very sound advice. There's a lot of wisdom in it.
Yep.
Okay. So we are going to move on.
We're
going
to try to cover these next few a little more quickly.
Yeah, we are. The next ones won't. Because we're not going to go all the way to 16. The last three just talk about studies they should be involved in.
Oh, that's right.
Advocacy they should be involved in.
We kind of said that.
Yeah. Psychologists, this is number 9. Psychologists strive to understand both the particular challenges that TGNC elders experience and the resilience they can develop.
Yeah.
So transgender and gender nonconforming elders are at a heightened risk for depression, suicidal ideation, loneliness in comparison to even their lesbian, gay, and bisexual elders.
What I think is interesting about this is what I alluded to before is, and this paper even says it, prior to the 1980s, transgender people or gender nonconforming people, and at the time, that included lots of kinds of people. At the time, that included cross-dressers and drag queens. It included all kinds of people. But transgender people who transitioned were strongly encouraged by their doctors to pass in society as cisgender. And what I found fascinating, which is a statement I hadn't heard, was sometimes they weren't even given the approval to transition, unless when they transitioned,
yes.
Right?
Yeah.
They were opposite sex attracted.
Right.
They were heterosexual in their transition, which we know does not happen.
Right. So if I'm trans male, once I transition to male, I need to be attracted to women.
Or the doctor wouldn't have given consent.
Right. Or there'd be no consent. You had to appear as a heterosexual
couple. Isn't that an amazing thing? So that was still happening in the 80s, and I would suppose in the early 90s it might have been happening. So when you're talking about elders, they come from a set of presumptions and expectations that were on them from when they were just trying to deal with this in their life. Maybe when they, you know, the studies show that there's bargaining that starts, rational bargaining that goes on in the head of a trans person at about 18 years old. So now if we've got a 68-year-old elder, 50 years ago, what the sort of set of circumstances they were being pressured to and having to operate under were completely
different
than what is happening.
Different.
So it's a whole new set of
So the
problems.
Issues we're dealing with here have a lot to do with financial well-being, financial stability. It says that, the TGNC and LGB elders had less financial well-being than their younger cohorts because things are changing. Despite having a higher than average educational level for their age group compared to the gender to the general population.
That's interesting. Yeah. But there's reasons for that, too.
They're better educated and not often, paid as well.
There's often this this sense of, since you can't form intimacy, or they couldn't form intimacy in other areas of their lives, they, you know, saying would be, throw yourself into your job and excel at that.
Right. Now, this is interesting. So TGNC elders may face obstacles to seeking or accessing resources that support their physical, financial, or emotional well-being. For instance, they may be concerned about applying for Social Security benefits, fearing their TGNC identity may become known.
What we were talking about before.
Right.
Yep.
So there are benefits that they qualify for that they may not be getting out of fear.
Yeah. And can you imagine in a nursing home situation, how does all of that play out?
Some TGNC individuals who enter congregate housing, assisted living, long-term care settings may feel the need to reverse their transition to align with sex assigned at birth to avoid discrimination and persecution by other residents and staff.
Yep. And I can absolutely see that would
be a
concern.
You see that at end of life when you're feeling as vulnerable as you are anyway.
Yeah.
When you're elderly and then having to go back to your birth gender, birth sex.
These are just all the things I, you know, just don't think about.
Yeah, right.
Yep.
Although some TGNC elders have experienced significant psychological trauma related to their gender identity, some have developed resilience and effective ways of coping with adversity. This is actually a 2015 study that's just showing how resilient many of these TGNC elders are. Despite the limited availability of LGBTQ affirmative religious organizations in many local communities, TGNC elders make greater use of these resources than their cisgender peers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you're talking about a greater use of the spiritual and religious resources in their area, which I think is great. But because of the social isolation, it's just a matter of what psychologists have to do is try to promote socializing.
Yeah.
That's what they're asked to do. Identify also, and some of this is identifying ways they can mentor and improve the resilience of younger TGNC generations so that they can create that sense of generativity. And then the other thing is that for TGNC elders who have chosen not to disclose their gender identity, psychologists may provide support to address shame, guilt, or internalize anti-trans prejudice and validate each person's freedom to choose their pattern of disclosure.
Yeah. Can you, I'm just so glad they're addressing everything from children to elders here. You know, because we often talk about the children, but we don't talk about the elders.
And if you think, you know, people are more out these days, more willing to talk about transitions that they've made, and elders may feel they've hidden for all these years and feel shame over it.
Yeah. Yep. Yep. So the next guideline.
Yeah.
The next guideline is that psychologists should strive to understand how mental health concerns may or may not be related to a TGNC's person's gender identity. So, I mean, the bottom line is this is we all have mental health stresses.
But in the past, it's been, oh, well, you're trans, so that's why you have these mental health issues.
Right. Which would be...
Because you have mental health issues, now you think that you're in the wrong body.
So, when you know, you hear this from the conservative point of view, which is kind of a catch-22. So you're mentally depressed, and of course you're mentally depressed because you're transgender, and that's out of the will of God. So this is saying, oh, please, can we stop this now? Can we say that being transgender, you also may have mental health concerns. Let's look at them as separate, together issues. Let's look at this and say, how can I best inform you that, yes, you're a transgender, gender nonconforming person that seems to have other things going on. Let's deal with those two and not just blame your transgender status on
that. No, because they found that that's really not the case. They're two completely separate issues.
What a surprise.
Yeah.
Cisgender people never have mental health problems. Yes.
It actually says psychologists are strongly encouraged to be cautious before determining that gender nonconformity or dysphoria is due to an underlying psychotic process, as this type of causal relationship is rare. But if you read the FRC paper, they're saying exactly the opposite.
That's right. Yes.
And it's not true.
So this person that they're all pushing out, Walt Heyer, or how you ever say his name, H-E-Y-E-R, who wrote a book to say, you know, it didn't work for me. Well, if the real problem with him was not that he had this gender dysphoria, the problem was he was a schizophrenic, and that's their poster child for this. So
yeah, really. So what FRC is saying is, well, if you're trans, that means that you're probably schizophrenic, and that's why you're trans.
Yeah,
so, and the American Psychological Association is saying, that is so rare, you better not assume that.
Yes. So,
and then a lot of the stress that trans people feel is the same as every other minority group feels.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So let's go to guideline 11.
The psychologists recognize that TGNC people are more likely to experience positive life outcomes when they receive social support or trans affirmative care. That pretty much speaks for itself.
It does. It says, you know what? You'll do better in your life if you're in community and
right,
relationship.
And you're not isolated.
What a surprise.
Yep.
I don't do too well if I have to sit around for a week by myself either. So the guideline 12.
Guideline 12. Psychologists strive to understand the effects that changes in gender identity and gender expression have on the romantic and sexual
yes.
relationships of TGNC people.
So this is exactly sort of the thing we were talking about before. So when people transitioned before, they were expected to stay heterosexual. So this section says, hey, if you transition, you may be heterosexual, you may be homosexual, you may be bisexual, you may be pansexual. Just because you transition to another gender doesn't tell us that you still have to stay in a binary. But this section also says that when you transition, this may have an effect on your romantic partner or your spouse. And we know of many situations.
And that these need to be dealt with. That the trans person needs to understand
yes.
what their transition, how their transition is going to affect their loved ones. That needs to be something that's discussed. And this is the last guideline that we're going to cover.
And that person that's also not transitioning, the romantic partner, the spouse, is also going to need a fair amount of support, too, because their life is changing.
Well, the study says what
could
we
be changing.
Just would intuitively know. It's that the earlier you disclose
yes.
trans or gender nonconforming feelings, the more likely a positive outcome with your partner mm-hmm. will occur, because mm-hmm. the longer you wait, the more likely they are going to feel betrayed.
Yes.
Like and you've that, kept something from them.
Yep. Yep. And that is what's written here is, so we both know of examples where people have transitioned after 20, 30 years and the marriage has ended because the other person doesn't want to appear to be in a homosexual relationship. Right.
Right.
But I also know other experiences where somebody early into the marriage told their spouse, this is where I am, spouse, total agreement with this, transitioned 20 years ago. Of course, to everybody in the outside world, they appear to be a lesbian couple, but one is trans, one is a trans woman, one is a woman, and they have successfully negotiated raising children together, and doing wonderful jobs. So
but you
just don't know.
You also have, okay, so a trans man, a trans woman who was prior married to a woman, and the woman doesn't want to appear as a lesbian couple,
right.
is uncomfortable with that. But it also works the other way, where you've had lesbian couples
yes.
where one of them transitions into a man and the other doesn't want to be in a heterosexual
she
couple.
She says, wanted to be with a man. I want to be with a woman.
Right.
So there's no, I've heard people say, well, why do you transition if you can't be in a heterosexual relationship? This is way more complicated than this. Get your heads out of the gender binary. Get your heads out of the gender sex. Get your heads out of the heterosexual world. This is a spectrum. spectrum of attraction, spectrum of sex, spectrum of identity, spectrum of how you express that to the outside world. We are not in a binary.
No, and I think that that has been the assumption all along.
Yes.
Is that there is this binary, or you would transition because you're a gay man. And so you're going to become a trans woman in order to appear heterosexual. I know you've heard this, Kathy.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I think it's in Iran, which is, I don't mean to muddy the waters, but they so don't want people to be gay couples that they ask one of the partners in a homosexual relationship to physically transition so that it can appear that they're in a heterosexual relationship. They're like, that's wild.
And what this paper is showing is that there isn't a correlation between gender identity and sexuality. Those are two different things.
But they were totally conflated until the late 60s, early 70s in this country, very early
70s. I'm surprised it's not later than that.
No.
This seems to be something that is still in people's heads today.
So often I've brought up one of my funniest books on my shelf is Everything You Wanted to Know About Sex, But We're Afraid to Ask. And the chapter on male homosexuality in there absolutely has this running through it. They cannot keep separate that there is a gender identity and a sexual orientation that are different things. They completely conflate it. So people that are older, there's no wonder in their heads this is all still conflated, because if you were 20 or older in the late 60s, this is what the experts told you. So these right. elder trans people, elder gay people, elder people have been told something in their formative years and they still believe it.
And the medical interventions I find interesting, hormones, surgery, don't necessarily change to whom you're attracted.
No.
But they can if you're now feeling more comfortable with
yes.
who you are and
yep.
your body. So
yep.
there is no one way.
Nope.
There is no one experience for
no.
all people. And, you know, I do always think about the partners, and it says, you know, the partner may then, and a trans or gender nonconforming person needs to realize this, and this is something that would be dealt with in therapy if they have a partner, is the grief that the partner may go through,
mm-hmm.
even if you're staying together, that they feel that they're losing the person that they were married to.
Right. So those are the, we know this has been a long podcast
yes.
today, but we wanted to finish this one. And the rest of the guidelines,
yep.
as Yvette said, are more about how the psychologists would participate in policy, in advancing their education, in helping to train the younger psychologists that are coming up. But what we're going to do something interesting, and we don't know. We don't know what's going to happen in the culture in the week, in the news in the next few weeks. But we have an intention, whether it be the next podcast or one shortly down the road, we're going to pick up, take this in contrast to a book that's probably the best out there from the purely classical, conservative Christian with a little progressive twist on it, on gender identity and gender nonconforming people, called Understanding Gender Dysphoria by Mark Yarhouse. And he's got some interesting things to say from a Christian point of view, which is very funny for me to say because I speak from a Christian point of view.
Right.
But his is more conservative. So we're going to be talking about that and how that,
and
what he's proposing.
And Mark Yarhouse runs with the conservative
Very
Christian
much so.
Crowd of, you know, the FRCs
And he advises
NARS
churches.
And those organizations. So we need to know exactly where he's coming
from. So that's the whole point of why we do podcasts. We try to inform. We try to help people have conversations. So in the conservative world, some of what we said may be too progressive. So we're going to show you what is being said in the conservative world. And believe me, tear at its edges and maybe not rip it to shreds, but we're going to yank at the edges and see what it really says. We're going to look at it, what it really says. So we'll be talking about that in the future. But, you know, Yvette, thanks for bringing this to our attention, because I didn't know this existed, and I find it, again, encouraging. Do you have any final words to say on this paper?
Well, I find it encouraging as well. And, you know, as a big proponent of therapy, I was very happy to see these guidelines. And I was a little scared when I started reading through them, thinking, oh gosh, what did they come up with? But I think they did an excellent job.
And just to that point where you say you're a big proponent of therapy. So if you, to understand some of Yvette's story about how she came out of the religious right, because she used to be a policy analyst at FRC and head of the women's ministry at Exodus International and a speaker for the policies of the religious right, politically conservative. Her story is in a great book, a very rich, dense, brilliant book called Never Not Broken, and you can get that on Amazon. And you'll see there that Yvette knows what she's talking about when she talks about this topic, because she is a proponent of therapy and how much therapy helped her to move from one place to another. So I strongly suggest her book, Never Not Broken, and it's on Amazon. And it's a good read. It was a very interesting read for me. And I kept thinking, man, I wish my mind worked like this and I could do this. This would be really interesting. Get me a paper, a quiet spot, and some crayons. color pencils, maybe. Because a lot of it was guided, and it just fascinating story. So Never Not Broken. So thank you for listening to this extremely long but very important. Share it with your friends that are trying to understand transgender and gender nonconforming people, parents who have children that are, you know, gender nonconforming. This might be a very wonderful resource, and they'll be thanking you for it, because it is the latest of what's happening there. So thanks for listening to us. We're the Sisters of Thunder. I'm Kathy Baldock.
I'm Yvette Schneider. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.